Hello, my name is Andrew Ahn Westover, and I'm the Key Pairing Director of Education and Public Engagement at the New Museum. I join you today from the unceded land of the Lenape people, and I'd like to begin by acknowledging and paying respect to Lenape people and elders and ancestors, past, present, and future. On behalf of the New Museum, I am glad to welcome you to today's conversation between Hank Willis Thomas and Margot Norton. This program series includes over a dozen artist conversations presented in conjunction with our current exhibition, Grief and Grievance, Art and Mourning in America. Programs like this are core to the New Museum's work of advancing new art and new ideas. I would particularly like to thank education and public engagement staff members, Andrea Calderes and Derek Wright, as well as the entire New Museum team for their help bringing this program together. New Museum digital initiatives are generously supported by Hermione and David B. Heller. We also thank our members and supporters, like you, who help make these programs possible. I will now share brief biographical notes about this program's featured artist. Hank Willis Thomas works across photography, sculpture, video, and collaborative public art projects to address how visual and verbal systems in popular culture can perpetuate bias and discrimination. His works invite viewers to question those systems, raising critical awareness for issues of inequality and injustice, and illustrating how art can be a catalyst to affect political and social change. Thomas's mid-career retrospective exhibition, All Things Being Equal, was organized by the Portland Museum in Oregon and traveled to Crystal Bridges Museum of American Art in Bentonville, Arkansas, and the Cincinnati Art Museum in Ohio. Recent solo exhibitions have been held at the ICA Miami, SCAD Museum of Arts in Savannah, California African American Museum in Los Angeles, the Cleveland Museum of Art in Cleveland, and the International Center of Photography in New York. In 2016, Thomas co-founded the artist-led collective Four Freedoms, a platform for creative civic engagement in the United States, which was awarded the 2017 ICP Infinity Award for New Media and Online Platform. Thomas was recently chosen to design Boston's Martin Luther King Jr. and Coretta Scott King Memorial in conjunction with Mass Design Group. He is also the recipient of the Gordon Parks Foundation Fellowship in 2019, the Guggenheim Foundation Fellowship 2018, Art for Justice Grant 2018, the AIMIA AGO Photography Prize in 2017, the Soros Equality Fellowship in 2017, and is a former member of the New York City Public Design Commission. A few logistical notes before we begin. This program will last for approximately 1 hour. If you would like to ask a question, feel free to use the Q&A function at any time by clicking the Q&A button located at the bottom of your screen to type your question. Please note that this program is being recorded, so your question will be recorded as well. If there is time, our speakers will answer questions during the Q&A at the end of the program. Finally, I encourage you to learn more about upcoming public programs and our full suite of exclusive digital content on our website, newmuseum.org. And now, without further ado, I turn the conversation over to the New Museum's Alan and Lola Goldring curator, Margot Norton.
Thank you so much, Andrew, and thank you to everyone who've joined us this evening. I'm so honored to be here today with Hank Willis Thomas to speak about his powerful, deeply moving, and poetic work, which is included in our Grief and Grievance exhibition at the New Museum, which is an exhibition originally conceived by the late legendary curator Oakley and Weser, and overseen by a team of advisors, including Naomi Beckwith, Glenn Ligon, Mark Nash, and Massimo Nogioni. And thank you so much, Hank, for joining me today. I'm so thrilled to have the chance to talk to you about your work. And before we kind of go into speaking about your works, specific works, I wanted to start with a question that we're starting with for many of our talks related to the Grief and Grievance show, which is about the show's curator, Oakley and Weser, who sadly passed away 2 years ago over the course of working on this, on the show. And I know that you knew Oakley, and so I wanted to ask if you remember the time that you first met and what your relationship was like.
I actually don't remember the first time I met Oakley because my mother, Deborah Willis, is an art historian and photographer, and photo historian, and they have been in communication and colleagues for a long time. I probably met him somewhere between snap judgments in the short century. But he has been like a major influence on me, an artist who works with the archive extensively, and also with themes of the post-war era and apartheid, which have been central to my work. And so when I did a show in 2014 at the Goodman Gallery in Johannesburg, Okwi told me exactly where to go to do research and kind of expand on the collection that I was excited about. And then I flew to Munich to go see the post-war show there. And we hung out at dinner, and it was awesome. But I just feel like everything he did was such a gift because of how much care and energy and research that he put into every show.
Yeah, totally. And I thought we'd actually kind of jump right into talking about the work in the show, which is up at the New Museum now. It's the work titled 14,719. And then we'll kind of move through other projects, making sure we have enough time to focus on more recent work. It was honestly hard to pick which projects of yours to focus on, I must say, because you have so many amazing projects and collaborations, and many in the works as well, which we'll get to later. And we'll certainly leave enough time for some questions too. So the title of this work, 14,719, represents the number of individuals who died from gun violence in the US in the year 2018, which is the year before you created this piece. And I just wanted to mention that I saw that in the years since, that number has jumped to over 15,000 people in 2019 and a staggering over 19,000 people in 2020, which is simply horrifying. And so in this work, you kind of borrowed this iconography and materiality of the American flag to create these 28-foot long banners that are stitched with rows of stars, and each star kind of stands in for a life lost. So my first question is if you could just talk a little bit about how the idea to create this work began.
Sure. Well, and thanks again for having me. And it's also a real honor to be in this exhibition and also to be an exhibition at the New Museum. It's also a pretty heartbreaking, not only because of the mourning of the person who conceived of it, but also the pandemic that we are experiencing and the grief and grievance that is part of far too many people's daily lives, in addition to the tragedy that we see in our country as a result of gun violence. So presenting a work like this, which comes from a very personal experience where my cousin and best friend and roommate, his name is Sunga Willis, was murdered by gunshot in 2000 on February 2nd. And from that moment on, my life took a dramatically different course because my whole game plan was to be his backup dancer, singer, really. And all of a sudden I had to find my own voice. And I have a lot of men in my family, my father included, who were veterans of foreign wars. And I recall when my grandfather died, the color guard coming and the wrapping of the American flag and presenting it to my aunt, to my grandmother, and also to my aunt, whose husband was also in the Vietnam War. And I also went to high school in Washington, D.C., where there are memorials for fallen soldiers of the Vietnam War and World War II, and also in downtown New York, there's a World War I memorial. And somewhere around 2010 or 11, I realized that since my cousin had died, another 200 or 300 people had died in our country as a result of gun violence. And during that same time where we had two foreign wars, approximately like 5,000 or 6,000 soldiers had died. And it just struck me as obscene that in some parts of our country that the death rate is comparable, if not dwarfing, that of a war zone for American soldiers. And while there will rightly be memorials for fallen soldiers, and probably should be, definitely should be memorials for the civilians who were casualties in those wars, we don't have any form of conversation or memorial for the victims of gun violence in our country. And so this piece was thinking about all of the falling stars, like my cousin, and wanting to pay tribute to them. And this is part of a larger kind of proposition that I'm moving forward with what it means to memorialize those who have fallen victims of gun violence. So there's an installation that just opened at the National Building Museum, a gun violence memorial in collaboration with Mass Design Group, where there are houses, glass houses, where the bricks are filled with the ephemera of people who have died. And that's also pretty touching. And so I'm just, yeah, it's I don't know how to talk about it because it just is, I feel so sad, but also in awe of it.
Yeah, totally. It was interesting to hear you kind of speak about those memorials that had an effect on it, because I feel like in this installation at New Museum, it has this, yeah, certainly like, you know, military aspect of it, and that like, they almost like fit perfectly in the space. I know that they have been installed differently before, but they're, you know, it almost confronts you, like you hit like banner after banner after banner, and it has this effect of like kind of coming up slowly, you know, just this overwhelming amount of stars that stand in for all of those people. And it's an incredibly important work. And I actually wanted to ask about the installation in particular, because in the next slide, there is an image of it installed in 2019, which is at your recent retrospective exhibition, All Things Being Equal. This is an image of it from the Portland Art Museum. And I wanted to ask you about how it's installed, because I can imagine this experience to be, you know, a very powerful one too, in a different way, in terms of being kind of confronted all at once with these banners. And so, yeah, I just wanted to ask a little bit about like the installation of it there, and if it's a work that can kind of change depending on the space.
Yeah, so it was installed here and then also at Crystal Bridges, where it took a different form as well, because not everyone has 28 plus foot ceilings and this much floor space to dedicate to it. And I was really just excited and impressed and humbled when Massimiliano actually proposed this idea, which is the stairwell is part, one of the kind of iconic aspects of this museum. And I've seen other work that was installed there that was really wonderful. And I definitely couldn't think of a better place for this work to be installed as a passage. And so, yeah, it's different when you can stand in the midst of it, but it's also for me pretty powerful to just be mesmerizingly looking up at it, or as you go down steps.
Totally. It's like one of my favorite installations in that spot. I just got to say, it looks amazing. So now actually you mentioned your mother in the beginning of the, you know, talking about Oakley, And before we kind of delve into talking about individual works, I actually wanted to ask if you could start speaking a little bit about your early experiences with photography in particular. I know you studied photography and visual criticism, and yeah, you must have just been exposed to, you know, such a you know, rich history of archival images through your mother, Dr. Deborah Willis, who is a MacArthur Award-winning curator, photographer, and photo historian. And when you were growing up, worked at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture in Harlem, and wrote crucial books, including this book called Reflections in Black, A History of Black Photographers, 1840 to the Present, which is the first comprehensive history of Black photographers and a groundbreaking contribution to the history of photography and art history. And I wanted to ask about how these early experiences growing up surrounded by these images and your mother's work kind of informed the work that you do.
Well, I hope we are all impressed with our parents. I did a Instagram Live with my mother 2 weeks ago on my birthday, on my 45th birthday, and her new book, Black Civil War Soldiers, was kind of the theme. And in the middle of it, I was like, wait, you're kind of a genius. Because you don't really think about your mom as a person, you know, or as a person who's independent of you. And of course, I know that my mom is, but it's still, I will always be her baby and she will always be my mom. And so, but then when I was like looking at it, I was like, oh yeah, no wonder they give you all these awards, because she realized something that is so obvious to all of us, but also so frightening, which is that she has something to say. And that if there are a lot of people who could say these things, who have chosen not to, and someone's got to do it. And what I found so impressive about her body of work, which are, it's now over 30 publications and hundreds of exhibitions, is that American history is far, 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 far more complicated than they teach us in school, and beautiful. And this idea of these limited few Anglo men who created this country and framed it for us to now be boxed in is not helpful to the actual story. And so when I look at her work, thinking about African Americans making photographs in 1839, almost three decades before the end of slavery in this country, well, unless you include mass incarceration, which means over a century, it's important for us to acknowledge that mass incarceration by definition, or incarceration in our country, is considered slavery, which is what the 13th Amendment allowed. And that was the loophole that has kept a certain portion of the population behind bars, the descendants of people of slaves. But yeah, it's when I look at my mother's photograph, her books, and I realize that, you know, there are people like her who are like, I'm going to make these images and I am going to show the world how important and how wonderful and how beautiful each and every person is, and especially African Americans. And the fact that this was happening at a time when it was illegal for people to read, much less own a business, to be at the cutting edge of science and art is pretty remarkable. And for my mother, you know, as a student, to have come upon these images and these stories and then develop this whole canon with her peers is pretty awesome. You hear my daughter screaming in the background. So it's a generational thing.
Oh, amazing, amazing. Yeah, we're like, just, yeah, so indebted. And yeah, so I thought we'd just jump into talking about some of your works, kind of starting with Branded, which is the next image, which is a series of work that I heard you describe as being part of your first major creative epiphany. And yeah, I just wanted to ask about that, the way that, you know, advertising and popular culture and your kind of like, I think real like dissecting and kind of looking at these images as a language in which we're kind of all kind of implicated is really powerful, and especially in relationship to how, you know, advertising can rely on prejudice as a way to sell products. So I just wanted to ask if you could talk about this epiphany and how it translated into this body of work.
You know what? It's a lot harder when you talk about it better than I do. So go ahead, keep talking.
No. It's like, I mean, I'll shut up now. You can
do that. Well, I'm curious. This image is very complicated. A lot of people look at this image, Scar Chest from 2003. And very few people really want to talk about the body that they're looking at, which is not mine, in case you were wondering. And that kind of legacy of marking Black bodies through scarification on the continent, as well as here, where yes, Black bodies were branded, but also they were keloided through whips. And chains. And I was really fascinated with this idea that my generation, you know, was sometimes referred to as the NTV generation. So literally a branded generation. And many of these brands, MTV included, but also Nike and others, built their businesses on the kind of mythology and awesomeness of Black, largely Black male bodies in this case, and the problematics of that, which meant that many of us were not seen as people. Yet instead, vessels for making money. And I wanted to talk about how we were branded as a sign of ownership in the 19th and 18th and 19th centuries. And now many of us brand ourselves. Like, we're even communicating through a brand on Zoom, and we're in the museum. New Museum is a brand, right? And now Hankolis Thomas is a brand. This idea that we can be identified and codified as belonging to something is something that begs the question of who actually is the owner. And that's where I'm asking myself that question every day. And so more, go on.
No, I was just going to say that, you know, you speak about this very eloquently. And I am actually like, in looking at this and hearing you talk, like thinking about that date too, of that this work was made, and about how that was really an era too, where all those brands were like very, those logos were like very much, potent, and like, you know, it was all about the logos, the way that fashion was at that time.
And now we just all have the same phone and don't ever question it. It's so ubiquitous, you know. So the next work is, I think, also inspired by that era, the bling bling era. And there was a revelation I had. First, that about how corporations were able to exploit Black bodies to make money. Then the realization that also a lot of the people who could be, for lack of a better word, tools in that were also becoming profitable and entrepreneurs in their own right, and that there would be a new kind of economic revolution, which seemed to be more capitalist in its base than before. And because thinking about when Jay-Z and Diddy and Russell Simmons and others became 100 millionaires, and now some of them are becoming billionaires, that their children will not live in the same world, but also in the same class kind of circumstances as they did. And it will change not only the places where those children go to school, but also change the whole industries that we knew. And little did I know that there would be a Black president soon after, and that there would be so much radical change in business as related to commerce around Blackness coming and being driven by Black entrepreneurs.
I'm going to quote you again, which is, I heard you describe logos as hieroglyphs embedded with meaning, which I love. And I think of language and the language of images and photography in particular as being one of the almost like primary kind of raw materials in your work. And I wanted to move into the next body of work, which is called Unbranded, where you're taking advertisements from the pages of magazines, some of which are archival images, which you kind of isolate and then take the text and logos off of the images to accentuate the prejudices that exist in the language of photography itself in consumer culture. There's a few images that I've selected here. And I just wanted to ask if there was a particular image or a series of images that prompted your thinking about starting the series. Did it grow from Branded, or was it something that kind of happened simultaneously?
Well, for me, I did grow up watching television and reading magazines. And for some reason, I was as enthused by the advertisements and the kind of coding of advertisements as I was the editorial content or sometimes the television shows. Because they're in like these 30-second spots or in a single page, there is this kind of huge task of trying to get so many people to buy into it. And this is a good example of, can you tell what this is an ad for?
Is that like McDonald's fries? Yes. In the background?
And the fact that you can look at an image of a backgammon table and four people and all of this food, and then immediately begin to frame it because of some small red packaging in the back talks about how literate we are in kind of in decoding advertising. And that's power when you can get people to like at a glimpse decode something. But there's other things happening in the image, which are the men are playing as the women are watching, right? And then there's this weird thing that happened in the directing of the models, is that the woman on the left is invited or coached to feed this guy this burger. But if you look at his right hand, he's got his own burger there. There's other social cues. This is an upper middle class, or at least a middle class Black youth, you know, so, which is something that was supposed to be a kind of exciting, radical for that moment. So at the same time that there is this progress, there's also this suggestion that there's a lot more progress to be made. And so what I love about looking at ads is that when you remove all the advertising information, you like see all of this other stuff. I don't know enough about backgammon to tell if it's even real, who's winning, but there's all of this other stuff that's happening. And it's like a window into that moment in time. It's the closest thing we have at this moment to like a time capsule.
Mm. Yeah, I included some images too from the Century of White Women part of the Unbranded series. Did this body of work kind of grow from the one originally that we showed before?
Yeah, so the first series was called Unbranded Reflections in Black by Corporate America from 1968 to 2008. And what I was really thinking about there is how advertising had adjusted to this emerging black middle class and wanted to track blackness in the corporate mind over the course of those 40 years and see how the conversation evolved. And there were some advertisements in the 70s that featured white women and black men in ways that were pretty provocative for the time, but were literally impossible just 5 years before that in 1969. And I wanted to, and I started to look at kind of different advertisements of white women, and I started to really, if you can go back to there's an installation shot, like four or five, the first slide from the Unbranded series. You see this image on the right is from that series in 1980, I guess. I can't remember which skin cream ad it was, but I was looking at it, I was like, this is, the mind that made this advertisement is pretty powerful. And you can put your money on, there were not many women involved in the making of this ad. And what I thought was really powerful also in all of these ads, the majority of people who are making these ads for black people and white women to consume are white men and who have a very specific agenda in how they relate to women and minorities. And this ad was like saying, I guess if you used their sun cream, you would look like the part of her on the left. And if you didn't, you would look like that on the right. And I just saw that there was so much social control happening in advertising of women subconsciously who were, and just the beauty industry in general, which is like preys on people being afraid of themselves, being afraid to be seen. And I just went down a rabbit hole. So I took 1915 was 5 years before the 19th Amendment was ratified, giving universal suffrage. And at the time I was predicting that Hillary Clinton was running for president and would win, which she did. And then she didn't. and I wanted to track that century, and so that was pretty exciting for me. And yeah,
oh, wow.
Amazing.
Totally. So if we can move forward to I Am a Man. I wanted to ask you about this piece because I feel like it's an excellent example of this kind of poetry and image play that I think carries throughout much of your work. And I understand that this sign originally came, the one that says, I am a man, came from an image by Ernest Withers that was taken at the 1968 Memphis sanitation strike, in which a large group of black men held the sign saying, I am a man. And so I wanted to ask about how you discovered that image and then decided to isolate and alter the message for this work.
Yeah, well, I was really in awe of this beautiful image of sanitation workers that were collectively affirming their humanity and their community and allegiance and brotherhood through this protest, which incidentally was a protest where Martin Luther King was assassinated in his efforts to offer his support in Memphis, Tennessee in 1968. So April 4th, and so what was that? Yeah. 52 years ago, 53 years ago, yeah. A few days ago. And I was astounded by that because the phrase I grew up with and the integration period was not I am a man, it was I am the man. And I started thinking also about when the Constitution was written in the Three-Fifths Compromise, where African Americans were counted as three-fifths of a human being. And I was thinking about Sojourner Truth, who's attributed to who the phrase "Ain't I a woman" is attributed to, and all of the different ways in which this "I am" can be something that is revelational and defining or confining. And so I looked at the top line as a timeline, and then I kind of wrote a poem which is out of place here, with the bottom line, which says, I'm the man, who's the man, you the man, what a man, I'm human, I am many, I am amen. Realizing that the greatest gift that any of us are given is our consciousness. The fact that we say I am and can be aware is a pretty profound and awesome gift. And we get so caught up in all of these other labels that we lose the plot. And because I grew up with, yeah, I'm the man, you know, and not recognizing that the man was also who was holding us back and holding us down. And now in this Eric moment where we're really reconsidering the validity of traditional gender definitions, I hope this work maintains relevance.
What is that man, you know?
Yeah, which is what's so exciting, right? Because when I just like, so that was 8 years before I was born. And like, I think 8 years ago, a lot of people would not have been able to imagine how much more accepting and rapidly, you know, people would be to kind of having a serious conversation about what is gender.
Yeah, totally. And I think that this work, you know, does call attention to that and its manipulations in terms of, yeah, how we identify or, you know, what we're trying to say by when we say I am. Kind of speaking.
The one that relates to you the most?
What?
Which one relates to you? Which one do you relate to the best?
I like the last one, honestly.
Because, can't use that one. That's cheating.
Well, no, I mean, I notice it's the title of the work, first of all, but also because it's something that you say collectively, you know? I mean, regardless of like the spiritual association with it, you know, it's something that relates to how you together with others are stronger. And I guess that's what responds to me with that one too. And also, you know, relating to the image itself, which we don't have an image of, but you know, it's individuals holding the sign that say, I am a man together. And obviously together in this protest, they're stronger, so. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Hit it again.
So moving forward, I wanted to ask about this reflective material that you've used recently. For a while now, but these are some recent works. This one called Turbulence, and these images can look like the one on the left side until they're shined on with a flashlight, or when you take a photograph of it with a flash, the image kind of reveals itself and these gold tones reveal themselves in this image. I basically wanted to ask how you found this material and why you decided to work with it to do this. Because I feel that there's this like inevitability these days of people taking images of artworks. You know, so many people just kind of enter museums, you know, smartphone first in terms of their experiences with them. And I think it's really, brilliant how you've kind of subverted and used that reality in these pieces.
Thank you. So yeah, this is a series. I miss the darkroom. I don't miss pouring chemicals down the drain and wasting water, but I do miss this magic of being in the dark room and putting a piece of paper in the developer and watching an image kind of emerge. There was something so magical about kind of the latent image being exposed. And in the digital age, that's become pretty antiquated and unnecessary. And I have always within my work been really interested in creating scenarios where the viewer can have some form of an epiphany or just like a little spark. And I realized that there's material that most of us see every day that actually does that, which is retroreflective. It's a material that they use on stop signs and street signs, which allow us to literally find our way in the dark. And that's also a metaphor for the struggle for human survival, where we are actually blindly finding our way. And it's also, I think, a good reference for the struggle for especially people who are minorities in this country to be seen at all. And that can, in this case, there's other image of protests, but also in Hollywood and also in sports. I've been kind of using this wayfinding material as something that gives me direction. And it sounds cheesy to say that, but this piece right here is an all-colored cast, and it's, I think, 36 of the most prominent actors of color, quote unquote, in the 50s, from the 30s to the 60s. And it's also inspired by Andy Warhol's, I can't remember, 36 Jane, I can't remember who Edith, someone could put in the chat. but I was also thinking about Andy Warhol and his way in which he used pop as politics, and didn't necessarily claim it, but also made it so undeniably.
Mm. Totally. Actually, somebody did put something in the chat.
Great.
Evel Skull 36 times.
Never.
Thanks, Scott. So the next series is Punctum, which draws inspiration from Roland Barthes, the French philosopher, his idea of the punctum in photography, which is the element which rises from the scene, shoots like an arrow, and pierces. In these works, you've kind of chosen the specific area of an image, which you've isolated and then created into sculptural form. I wanted to ask you actually about the next slide in particular, which I think is an incredible work. Particularly, it's called Looking for America, which you can see in the slide. I know the image that this piece is taken from, and I think that's why I responded to it so strongly, but particularly in the strategy of kind of taking this fragment of this body, kind of almost like floating in space with these, fragmented arms, pulling and holding this figure. I basically just wanted to ask you about the strategies of taking this from the photograph into three-dimensional space and how you feel that can kind of activate or change the viewer's experience of that image.
Yeah, so again, it goes back to my experience as a photographer and this idea. What we do as photographers is we just stare and we look. And I don't know about other people, but for me, when I click the camera, especially with a single lens reflex, there's a crunch. There's like a crunchiness and there's like a freezing sensation. And I always wondered what it would be like if you could do that in three-dimensional space, if you could just take a picture and then go inside it and walk around it and the phenomenological experience of that. And that's what stuck with me in Camera Lucida by Roland Barthes, this idea that there is something that pierces you, that sticks with you. And along came 3D scanners. And all of a sudden, of course, it's not all in just one click, but there are three-dimensional scanners that now, and 3D printing models that allow us to actually photograph and stitch together something in three-dimensional space. And so this is based off of an iconic photograph of Danny Lyon of Clifford Voss, who was a civil rights activist in Maryland, being pulled on one side by protesters who were doing sit-in with him, and then on the other side, National Guardsmen. And I just was in this idea of this person's body being literally pulled apart by the state and by the people. It's something that was really profound to me, and that he had one arm on the rooted. And later, when I looked into his story, he was the person who designed the bikes in Easy Rider. Yeah. And for there to, Easy Rider is not a movie that you think about Black people in, but the history of those bicycles is rooted in Black recreational life. And the fact that the Black man designed the Captain America bike and then was written out of not only the film, but also out of the history of the film for 50 years, was something that I also was like, I think this piece also speaks to. Mm. And so that's kind of what each of those different pieces to me is about.
Yeah, there's this also this relationship that you have to it. I think as you like walk around the piece, like, and like the hands are those that are kind of like seizing him, but also those that are holding him back. So like you're also kind of implicated in this relationship of power, even just in your, you know, circumambulating the work. Mm-hmm. So the next image is Remember Me, which I just saw is included in the exhibition that opened yesterday at the Speed Art Museum in Louisville, Kentucky, Promise, Witness, Remembrance, which reflects on the life of Breonna Taylor. But of course it's a work that you made in 2014. But also, you know, certainly speaks to, ideas of remembrance and how important that is. And, you know, Breonna's life and the lives of so many others. And I wanted to, just ask if you could talk a little bit about where the phrase came from originally.
Yeah, I should have sent it to you. the Amistad collection at the Wadsworth Athenaeum has an incredible archive of Black postcards. And many of them are racist, and many of them are anti-racist. And when I say anti-racist, their existence refutes the narrative. And there was an image which I gotta find again, but it's actually easily findable in my thousands of files, that I found of a Black man standing on a farm, presumably in the South, wearing a World War I cavalry hat and a white blazer, holding a shotgun. And when I turned it over, all that was written was "Remember Me" in this handwriting. And I was flabbergasted, because it was as if the person who wrote that was sending me a message. And I don't know if that was the same person who was in the picture, but it was something that I could never forget. And at the end of the day, isn't that all we ever want? Dead or alive, well, maybe not dead, but in our lifetimes or after, is to be remembered.
Yeah. And in your recent retrospective, All Things Being Equal, you included this, this is from the Cincinnati Art Museum, alongside this work, Bearing Witness, Murder's Wake, which speaks about your cousin. And yeah, I wanted to ask if you wanted to talk a little bit about this and who it is that's in the portraits.
Sure, so this is a selection of portraits that I took after my cousin was dead as a way again to locate myself, because I didn't know, I was so over invested in my existence being reliant upon his that I didn't know who I was without him and didn't want to. And spent and continue to spend a lot of time trying to figure out who I am and what I'm and why me or why him and not me, and making the most of it. But I also recognized in the time that I was in my mourning process that there were other people who were also mourning him, and that in a way I could spend time with him by connecting with people who knew and loved him and were witness to his life. And so I call it an incomplete portrait of Sangha through the people who knew and loved him.
That's super powerful. We're gonna actually next show a short video, which was created by Hank and Kambui Olajimi, titled Winter in America from 2005, which is a stop motion animation video, which recreates the events kind of leading up to the robbing and murder of Sangha Thomas Willis, Hank's cousin, which took place outside of a club in Philadelphia. And the narrative comes from accounts of those that witnessed this tragedy.
Underground, underground, when I stop the ground. Like a million elephants, a silverback orangutan. You can't stop a train. Who wants some? Don't come unprepared. I'll be there, but when I leave there, better be a household name. Weatherman telling us it ain't gonna rain. So now we sitting in a drop top soaking wet. In a silk suit, trying not to sweat. Hit somersaults without the net. But this will be the year that we won't forget. 1999.
Yo, man, that was a good night, man. Glad I met you, brother. I ain't had fun like this in a long time.
That's what I'm saying, all right? You had crazy fun tonight, right? Grandma home. Man, listen, this spot here is the John on Tuesday nights. Yo, I ain't seen you in what, 15 years? Yo, when you gonna stop bullshitting in New York? Come back home, man. Philly.
Y'all some wild boys.
I'm saying
that whenever y'all wanna come to New York, we can do this every night. To be honest, it does feel good to be near the family. Y'all feel me? It's cold out here. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
Oh! Yo, where you been hiding?
I'm not out here, Tyrose. Tyrose would have told me if he was coming out tonight.
Real.
That ain't the truth.
Ooh, what's up, baby?
Nah, I was just kicking it with my boy from back in the day. I ain't seen him in like 200,000 years. I had to call him 6 times, just to get him leave his grandmama house. Whatever. Here, Teddy.
Yo, what's up, y'all?
Yo, y'all know Teddy. Yo, and this is my man, Sangha.
How y'all feeling?
Yeah.
Yo, what's up? Yo, it's nice to meet y'all, but I left my coat in the car, so I gotta run. It's so cold out here, I feel like I'm gonna turn into chocolate pudding pop in a minute.
Total package over there. Give me the lie.
Yeah, she was fine, but did you see the joke?
Yo, hold on.
Yo, is he doing snow angels?
Hey, Sangha. Yo, what are you doing, man? A second ago, you freezing, Mr. Pudding Pot. Now, you rolling around in the snow. You gonna fuck around to catch pneumonia. We ain't kids no more, man.
Yo, that's a nice chain.
Who the fuck are you?
Wish I had a chain like that.
Hey, man, yo, we ain't even got nothing.
Man, give it up.
Hey, man, who are you, man? We all good people here, you know what I'm saying?
Yo, are you really trying to rob us in front of all these people, man? Yo, I can't believe this shit, man.
Shut the fuck up and give up your shit.
We all about love and shit, man.
Man, don't fuck with me. Just
don't move. Yo, give them your keys.
Come on, man. Chill, man. Chill. This chain ain't even real, man.
Stay down.
It's shining, man.
Come on, bro. How you gonna do that to him, man? He just got that chain. How you gonna do that?
Man, just give up your fucking chain.
Just fucked up, man. He was having a good ass night.
Oh, let's go, let's go. Yo, come on, come on, come on. Let's get the fuck out of here. Oh, fuck. Birdo.
Oh, man, I thought you was watching him. Where the fuck they go? Fuck it, let's get out of here, man. Let's get the fuck out of here.
Yo, come on, man, come on. Yo, what'd I do with him?
Yo, just leave him. Fuck it, man. Just bang him. Just bang him. Just do it.
And now it's a winter. Winter in America. Yes, and ain't nobody fighting, 'cause nobody knows what to say. Save your soul.
Thank you. I watched this earlier and I saw in the credits that at the end, like after you're thanking everyone, you thank G.I. Joe, the greatest American hero. And I wanted to ask specifically about that decision to retell this story using these action figures in particular.
Yeah, well, I used it. I told the story of my cousin's murder with the toys that I played with my friends. My cousin was never really into action figures, but where we created scenarios around violence before we could even really read, right? And that, you know, from 5 years old, which is what the designated age on the box is, when I was growing up and probably today, boys were given guns and then allowed and encouraged to fantasize around killing. And in most of the movies that we also watch that are blockbusters and most of the TV shows center, you know, and dramatize and mythologize murder. And I wanted to kind of talk about how I participate in systems that I find to be abhorrent, and the complexity around that in for myself. But for a long time, I couldn't listen to certain music and I couldn't watch certain movies. And even now I had to leave the room just to watch this. But at the same time, I got seduced right back into it.
Wow. Yeah, no, I can imagine needing to leave the room to watch it. But, you know, thank you so much for it. And yeah, it's an incredibly important message. And kind of moving to, I think a more, for me, kind of hopeful image. This is, I wanted to ask you about your work in public space. This is a piece called All Power to All People that was installed in Philadelphia, which is right across the street from City Hall. You know, certainly at a kind of prominent crossroads here. I included some other images here of some other kind of public pieces that you've done, including some that you're working on currently. Just wanted to ask a little bit about working in public space, what that means, and how you're kind of reconfiguring these monuments, if you will, the language of monuments.
Yeah, well, it's a real honor and an absurd opportunity and ridiculous process to make art and put it out into the public. And of course, the legacy of it goes back to, I guess, ancient Egypt in many ways, where human beings wanted to make a marker to celebrate people and things that they thought were transcendent. And this is a rendering of a sculpture that will be put in Boston Common, which is the oldest continuously used public space in the United States of America. It's done in collaboration with Mass Design, and it pays homage to the legacy and love of Coretta Scott and Dr. Martin Luther King. And in this piece, you can see the ripple coming out of their embrace. And it's meant to kind of acknowledge what energy comes from us two people coming together, what the potential of that is. And so I try as often as I can to remind myself and others not only to be grateful, but to be aware of our potential. And so unity, where the arm points up to the sky, and the 9 and 20 foot acro picks, which with the fist are just hopefully a little reminders to encourage us to think of how we are all connected.
I love how that this work and many others are kind of centering these acts of love, and this one in particular with the embrace, in a spot where, you know, we normally kind of see these monuments to like some kind of military victory. I think it's great. What do you know when this is gonna go up? Do you have any idea?
It's scheduled to be released in 2022.
Awesome. I will open it up in a few to questions from the audience. But before we do, I wanted to make sure I asked you about For Freedoms. I'm a big fan of the work that you've been doing. For Freedoms is a artist-run super PAC, a political action committee, which you founded with Eric Gottesman, Michelle Wu, Wyatt Gallery, and Joanna Bellarato Samuels in 2016. You've been doing great work with the organization in the past, like 4 years or so, 5 years. And I wanted to ask about how the idea to start For Freedoms began.
Probably the same way that the New Museum began. People just with the crazy idea. There's a long tradition of artists and creatives coming together to stake new claim. And I, for one, have always been invested in the space where we're told stories, which is advertising in public, and ask the question for myself is, inspired by artists like Mike Mendel and Larry Sultan and Barbara Kruger and so many others, what happens if we use this public space that's designated for art to sell ideas instead of products? And great art asks questions, great design answers them. There are now five of us who are listed as co-founders, but even the framing of founder is problematic in a 21st century lens. And we're constantly trying to reconsider how we can make the work and make an impact. We've collaborated with thousands of artists in all 50 states, plus DC and Puerto Rico and Guam and the US Virgin Islands. We've done over 300 billboards a lot of other programming, et cetera. And, you know, it really is an attempt to challenge the status quo, because we know that we can, and that's what art is at its best meant to do.
Totally. And I wanted to also ask about the 2020 Awakening, which is the latest project for Freedoms that launched last year. And this, I love this Rules of the Infinite Game, especially the bottom part, and seriously, don't take yourself too seriously. I wanted to ask you a little bit about the Awakening and how one gets involved.
Well, if you're sure, thank you. We came upon this 19th century movement that was sparked up in 1860 that changed the world forever, and it was called the Wide Awakes. And this last year was always going to be a miraculous year. You know, it was 2020. And so we were thinking about who are the Wide Awakes of 2020, thinking about hindsight being 2020 and having 2020 vision. We wanted to kind of frame that in the political landscape and through using art and social action. And I was given a book by a friend called Finite and Infinite Games, A Vision of Life as Play and Possibility by James Carse. And this theologian / game theorist posited that there are at least two types of games. Finite games, which are games that come to end when someone has won or lost, and infinite games, which are played for the goal of continuing the state of play. And I think about colonialism as a finite game, and a lot of the ways we relate to capitalism and gender and race as finite games. But human beings have been on this planet for seemingly 200,000 years and have flourished. And that was because they were playing an infinite game, that they did not take more than they needed. They were not conquering nature. They were participating in going along with it. And we wanted to kind of put these ideas back into the conversation. And we came up with these rules collectively. And I just need to ask you to read, let's alternate reading the rules.
You got it. So the first one is, no one plays alone. You know nothing you need to know. The rules always change. Love overrules.
Rule number two is, there are no gatekeepers. Bring people into play. Be where you are. And carry your own trash.
Rule number three, learn from feeling. Let love quiet fear. Nourish joy. Go there.
Rule number four, you're just in time. Leap before you look. You know everything you need to know. Together we are awake. And seriously, don't take yourself too seriously. Play on, player. but this idea, these are rules to live by if you're wanting to stay in the state of play.
Awesome. So if anybody has any questions, please put them in the chat. And while you do, I wanted to ask if you could talk a little bit about what you're working on now. I mean, of course, the Boston project, which I'm sure is a lot, but if there's anything else you wanted to mention.
Let's say that again. Sorry.
What you're working on.
What am I working on?
There's a lot of
things. Working on paying attention. I'm just working on I mean, I don't know if it's possible to live your values. Mm. I think it's important, much like the rules, to define them. And in a time when so much is changing, there's a lot to think about. And what I didn't talk about in the 2020 awakening is that we all had an awakening in 2020. That the world won't be the same for quite some time. And maybe that's always true, but this is the first time that many of us collectively came to that realization at the same time and woke up to the reality that everything we do and who we do it with and how we choose to do it matters. Mm. And that's a powerful awareness. And I am doing my best to think about my reentry with that level of mindfulness.
Mm. Awesome. So a few questions came in. We have time for a few. One is relating to Winter in America, which was that I thought Kambui was doing that kind of work with action figures before this piece, and if you were inspired by his other films.
I don't know. This was 2005. Kambui and I have been best friends since 1995. So, and much of what we have done, we've done simultaneously or together or accidentally, but I can't think of anything he did. I remember he maybe did some things with logos in 2002, but I don't recall. He's done some really great stop motion films since then with action figures. He's an incredible artist and an amazing human being. Mm.
And yeah, I just wanted to mention too, just to clarify that the image in the PowerPoint was a image that is from 2013, but the film is from 2005. So maybe that was where the confusion came from.
I like the different dates because it just allowed me to.
I'm just, you know, messing with you with these dates. We have time for two more questions. Sorry. This question is there a reason why certain words were capitalized throughout certain sentences in the last, the awakening work, I think?
That would be a good question for whoever wrote it. Mm-hmm. I contributed a couple lines, which I think are love over rules, but really my cousin Sung contributed that one, and there was another one. But that was also the beauty of this collaboration, and that's beauty of Four Freedoms is they're all, and it's the unfortunate part is that I get undue credit. The incredible part is just seeing that most of our greatest things, no one knows who exactly did what, but I presume that there was a reason for that.
Awesome. And then Julia Paul asked, this is the last question. I was wondering if you could talk a bit about the sculpture works at your exhibition at Kane Griffin Corcoran.
Sure. Well, I had two sculptures in my exhibition at Kane Griffin Corcoran Gallery in Los Angeles in January 2020. One was a deconstructed motorcycle, the Captain America motorcycle that was I talked about, was featured in Easy Rider. And then the other was the Dukes of Hazzard car, the General Lee, which was appended and standing on at the hood mid-crash. And that was really, I grew up as a lot of African-Americans did, loving the Dukes of Hazzard television show. And I even had the General Lee car, not knowing at all, and no one ever pointing out to me that I was supposed to be offended by the Confederate flag and that the show was really a tool to whitewash the Confederacy and ingratiate us to the legacy of slavery and white supremacy. It's like, darn it. I love that show. So I've always been in this kind of complicated situation, like with the G.I. Joes, where, and also with the American flag, which is a beautiful, iconic symbol of so much good, while also being a horrific symbol of so much horror for so many people. And my own need to try to like find myself in that. And so I think, thanks for asking about those two sculptures. And I saw the connection between Easy Rider really being the intro into Dukes of Hazzard, which is about a couple of good old boys still meaning harm, they're outcasts, and society doesn't have a place for them. And realized that it was just repackaged from this 1969 film to this 1978 television show, featuring a car from 1968.
Mm. Well, that's all the questions. Hank, this was awesome. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you. It's a really awesome exhibition. Thank you to all the people who came. I always am shocked when I hear people talking about, like, I say, oh, I'm the me, because I really feel that everything I do is just a part of each and of all of us. Mm. And so I'm just so grateful to get to share some time and now have a deeper connection with you. And I really am so grateful to all the people who share this time with us. Thank you from Bogota. Hi, Sarah McEnany.
Hi, everyone. Same here. Totally. Thank you for coming, everyone, and sharing in this space with us.